our today's speaker, Mr. Tejas Vora. He's been practicing in the appellate as well as the original side of this very high court. He's one of us, but the excellence he has achieved in the field of law is something exceptional and we should all aspire to achieve. He's graduated from the prestigious Government Law College. He's been working in the chambers of senior advocate Mr. Nitin Thakkar. He's a master when it comes to the matters of succession law, testamentary and interstate succession. And there are many matters in which he has been appointed as amicus curiae by this court, and many matters, many reported judgments in his name. So without further ado, I request Mr. Tejas Vora to kindly take charge.
Honorable President, Western India Advocate Association of Western India, Mr. Sanjeev Kadam, Honorable Secretary, Adhivakta Parishad, Mr. Ram Redis, Mrs. Anjali Helekar, Shrimati Shri Anand Naikar, my esteemed seniors and the friends. First of all, I would like to thank the Adhivakta Parishad and Advocate Association for giving me this opportunity to give this lecture. I was fortunate to have witnessed the practicing of Mr. our senior advocate V.T. Walavalkar. Since last breath he had practiced in this High Court, I must pay my tribute to him before I starting my lecture. Now, as far as jurisprudence of succession. Now, what is succession? Now, we all know that our main object of the human life is four objects: dharma, artha, kam and moksha. When we go for, as far as artha is concerned, there are various interpretations, but we take in the very ordinary sense, creation of wealth. And our life is mainly divided in three phases. First phase, up to 30 years, we think, what about me? I have to achieve this, I have to become this. Then after 30 to 60, what about us? Means we think of our family and we have to look after their welfare. And after 60, and the creation of wealth is during the period of 30 and 60. And after 60, then we think, what after me? At that point, the distribution of the wealth, management of the wealth, how wealth is to be given to whom, after you depart this world, everybody would like to see that the wealth which he has created with the labor and hard work is properly born to the right person and it goes to the right heir. Sometimes there are unfortunate incidents that they don't want to give to the rightful heir, but they want to give who has helped them. That is why the concept of will has come, but I'll come later on that. Now, as far as succession is concerned, it relates back to the Vedic period, because our, you all know, India is a various cultures and religions and a unity in diversity. And as far as the personal laws are concerned, like marriage, adoption, succession, we all are governed by the personal law. Hindus are governed by the Hindu laws, Muslims by Muslims, Christians and Parsis. So as far as our laws are concerned, the text, all our ancestors in their wisdom, they decided how the wealth should be given to the heirs. Who are the heirs? That our roots of the, our laws goes back to the Vedic period, Manusmriti, and that is how we derived that. Of course, later on the laws were codified, and ultimately there are two branches. And then when the concept of the will came, that time it was decided the person who has earned his own wealth, he should have a right whom to give, whom not to give. It is his discretion, and that is how the will was, concept of the will came. That is the last desire of a person, that how his wealth should be distributed or dealt with after his death. So will creates artificial succession. So once will is there and proved, then it supersedes the succession law. Now, as far as the succession is concerned, we can put it the succession without will and the succession with will. First, I'll deal with the succession without will. There are five types of grants. First is heirship certificate. Second is succession certificate. Third is letter of administration. And fourth is letter of administration with will annex. And the last is the probate. Now, heirship certificate, first, now these are, as far as first four, five are concerned, they are intestacy. So, succession is divided in the two branches, intestate and testate. So, intestacy, when there is no will, then the law operates and property goes and divided between the heirs as per the law prescribed. And there is a heirs and everything is concerned. And those heirs and everything relates back to 1,000 years back, when the Vedic period, when the Manusmriti and everything, so our rishis and in their wisdom, they decided who will get and how much they will get. So as far as, now first I'll explain in nutshell what is the heirship certificate. As the name indicates, now as far as the succession is concerned, it's mainly governed by Indian Succession Act, whether intestate or testate. Even if will is there, the provisions are applicable to the by the Indian evidence, Indian Succession Act, and if will is there, also Indian Succession Act. And mainly, as far as Bombay is concerned, we have our original side jurisdiction. So Bombay is a district court for High Court is a district court for Bombay. So High Court original side rules decide the procedure for testamentary and probate proceedings. So mainly two acts as far as the Bombay is concerned. Indian Succession Act and the original side rules. Outside the Bombay in district, acts are the same, but in Bombay the probate is compulsory, and outside the act, the district court, you have to make application for probate and letter of administration. Now as far as heirship is concerned, the name indicates, it's mere declaration that who are the heirs. Property of the schedule is not mentioned. And prior to 92, it was a city civil court had jurisdiction. But after 92, the judgment of Justice Dhanuka, as he then was, then the jurisdiction was transferred to the High Court, and the heirship is issued by the High Court. Now, earlier heirship as a very limited issue, because the less court fee was payable, properties were not mentioned. So it is for the transfer of tenancy, agriculture, land and everything. As far as Bombay is concerned, now High Court is concerned, and outside the Bombay, Tahsildar's office issues the heirship certificate. But it has a very limited scope, and any husband, wife, children, anyone can apply for heirship certificate. Proclamation is issued, and if everybody, there is no objection, then heirship is granted. Second is succession certificate. Now succession certificate is on mainly for immovable property. Now these all are when there are no will. There is no will. Heirship certificate, now succession certificate is only for the movable properties like money, cash, shares and everything. Now you have to file petition, and as far as the court fee is concerned, the maximum court fee of approximately market value of the property is 11 lakhs, then maximum court fee is 75,000 for the succession, letter of administration, probate and letter of administration with will annex. Maximum court fee is 75,000, then whether property is 50 lakhs, 1 crore or 100 crores. On civil side, you all are aware, maximum court fee is 3 lakhs. Now succession, any one heir can apply. Now but jurisdiction, where it has to be applied? Then succession has to be applied where the residence of the deceased, where the deceased was decided last before his death, that is the jurisdiction which decides the filing of the succession certificate. The property, whereabouts of the property is not concerned. Suppose he has a share of which registered public limited company, where the shares are of the Calcutta registered office is there, or Madras is there, but if his residence of the Bombay, then the succession certificate can be applied at the Bombay High Court. Now Bombay High Court is a chartered High Court, so grant of the Bombay High Court has effect throughout the India. Only chartered High Court seva effect throughout the India. Bombay High Court is a chartered High Court because it is appointed by the Royal Charter. So the grant of the Bombay High Court, so property wherever in India, it can be covered under this grant, succession. Now in succession, suppose all heirs gives consent, because after filing, because one of the heir, because there is no will and only movable property, so you have to ask all the heirs. Heirs, who are the heirs now? The person who is entitled to get on interest trustee, those are the heirs which is specified in the act. For example, we take Hindu succession. Section 8 is for the male and heirs of the male, section 15 is for the female. So then you have to issue the citation. Suppose somebody doesn't give consent and object, then you have to make an application for justifying surety. Means as far as his share is concerned, you have to justify and his share is protected, then you are entitled to get. And it is not, they can file objections and ultimately court will decide whether the person who has applied for succession certificate is entitled to take or not. And what about the shares? Because here one applies, but he applies on the basis for the benefit of all. He becomes trustee as far as other shares are concerned. So if he justifies and deposit in the High Court, then there is no problem. Now this is succession is only for movable. Now suppose there are movable and immovable property, then you have to file letter of administration when there is no will. Now letter of administration comes under section 290 of the Indian Succession Act. Now first, where it can be filed? The letter of administration can be filed either where the property or the part of the property is situated, or and the residence of the deceased. Either anyone, suppose he is the residence of the Bombay, properties in some immovable properties in Maharashtra, something is in Gujarat. So you can file letter of administration, because ours is the Royal Chartered High Court. So we have a grant as a original, it's enforceable throughout the India. Now once a letter of administration is filed and any one heir can apply, then again citation has to be issued. And suppose there is no dispute, and generally there cannot be dispute, because there is no will, then only you apply for letter of administration, otherwise you have to apply for probate. So generally, even if somebody opposes, then you are entitled to take out application for dismissal of the his caveat or objection. Then court will consider what is the reason why. Suppose he says, I have a will, then you should file the probate petition. Then if a will is there and the probate petition is filed, then the will supersedes, once probate is granted, it supersedes all the proceedings. Now letter of administration, then suppose it is granted to that person, there is no objection and everybody consent, then he becomes administrator, he becomes trustee. He has to administer the property and distribute the property to all the heirs in accordance with their share. So just because he has obtained the letter of administration, it does not mean that he will take away the property. He becomes the trustee, is answerable to the court, and is also answerable to the other heirs. And he can be sued if he does not, and there is a provision for removal of administrator also, and the executor also, under section 301 of Indian Succession. Since you all are writing, I am going slowly. Now, who can file letter of administration? Anyone heir, next of kin, who is going to inherit, can file letter of administration, and citation is served to all, and then whether he objects or that will decide the further proceedings. Now we come to the letter of administration with will annex. Now letter of administration with will annex, when it is filed, when person makes a will. Now you all know we always make a will. Will has to be simple, straightforward, and it should be very simple, and it must reflect the wishes of the deceased. Sometimes we have to honor the wishes of the deceased when he comes for drafting of the will. We know that it is not relevant, but sometimes, because ultimately it is the last document which the person makes before his death, and which will comes into operation after the death of a person, and the succession opens at the time of the death. So suppose sometimes the person makes his own will with the help of the layman and the executor is not appointed. Executor means who takes charge of the property, applies for the probate and then administers the property as per the directions given under the will. Suppose there is no executor, then you have to read the will and you have to see by tenor if somebody is given power to enforce the will after probate is granted, then he can be called executor. So if executor is clear, then clearly mentioned in the will, so probate can be applied. But if there is no executor, then anyone, heir and next of kin, can apply for letter of administration with will annexed. But here also very surprising, when letter of administration is to be filed, the first preference is given to the residual legacy, universal legacy. And if there is this residual, universal legacy and residual legacy, they get the first preference to file letter of administration. If they are not there, then the heir can file the letter of administration with will annexed. It's equivalent to probate, only the name differs because there is executor is not named in the will. But he once administer gets the LA with will, what we call in short, then he has to enforce all the directions and the wishes of the deceased as per the mention in the will. Now we come to the probate. Executor is appointed, then executor will apply for the he files the probate petition, he brings will to the court and I am applying. Now the real process starts, because the once will is proved, then it is an artificial succession. Once will is a piece of paper unless it is probated. As far as Bombay, Calcutta, Madras are concerned, and Bombay, probate is compulsory for transfer of immovable property. Otherwise, you can apply for probate petition in a district court. But if you want to clear the title of the immovable property, if it is covered under the will, then the probate is must. Because in our Indian society, people have wrong three impressions mainly. That will has to be on stamp paper only, which is not correct. It can be on a piece of paper, it can be in the reverse of the bus ticket also. Only the conditions of the will has to be fulfilled, our will is to be proved, that I later on. Second, third thing, that once will is registered, it cannot be challenged. There is no will which cannot be not challenged. Any will can be challenged, even if it registered. And third, person thinks that if I am a nominee under the will, I am a nominee of a certain property, then I am entitled to take away that property. So nominee is a mere trustee. From the death of a person who owns the property till it is distributed among the rightful heirs. Even if nominee transfer the property, then the heir can sue him that he cannot transfer. Now, as far as executor and administrators are concerned, under section 213 of the Indian Succession Act, the moment the person dies, the executor and administrator step into the shoes of the deceased. And they are entitled to take, powerful to take all legal steps for the protection of the property which deceased could have taken. They can file a suit for protection of the property without waiting for the probate. Because in that is called the suit for administration and the protection of the property, but it will be, these suits can be filed on the original side as far as High Court is concerned. Because testamentary court has very limited power. They will decide whether will is genuine or not. They are not concerned with the contents of the will. One can bequeath Taj Mahal and Qutub Minar in the will, no problem. The court will see will is genuine, two witnesses are there. They have seen the deceased signing, he was in proper frame of mind and will is properly executed. It is proved in accordance with the section 5963 of the Indian Succession Act and section 68 of Indian Evidence Act. Now, as I have said earlier, will is a piece of paper unless it is probated. The question of construction, interpretation and implementation of the will comes only after probate is granted. So before probate is granted, will is a piece of paper, and therefore construction, interpretation and implementation of the will, the remedy is a civil suit if the executor fails. Because once probate is issued, then the court is ex officio, functus officio for as far as the probate petition is concerned. Now I'll take you to how the probate is to be obtained once will is. Once executor comes with the High Court and he has to approach all the heirs, he files the probate petition, executor, and all the consent affidavit of the heirs are, he requests them, can you give consent, because I am the executor, I have to obtain the probate. Now, this all the heirs, whether they get under the will or not, their consent is required, because if on interstacy they get, they have a caveatable interest. Now, caveatable interest is not defined under Indian Succession Act. There are many judgments on that. One famous judgment of that Birla versus Lodha, 2008 Supreme Court. Now, it of course, that matter is, it was decided by division bench of the Supreme Court. Now, matter is referred to the full bench of the High Court, but that is still good law. And it analyzed that what is the caveatable interest. Now, caveatable interest, the test is that on, if interstacy, if a person is entitled to get or is getting, then he has a caveatable interest. And either he shows a special interest, like suppose there are two wills. Now, as far as will is concerned, only the last will is to be proved first. The moment last will is proved first, earlier will goes, automatically get cancelled. So, if he approach the all the heirs and ask for the consent, if they give the consent, all the heirs give the consent and accept the will, nothing like that, then automatically then matter becomes non-contested. But affidavit of the attesting witness is to be filed along with, now that procedure for filing of the petition and for affidavit, that you will find in original side rule books. Whether testamentary disposition or intestate succession, the procedure is by Indian Succession Act. But as far as High Court procedure is concerned, it is the original side rules. Now, suppose some of the heirs says we are opposing the will, we are not accepting the will for whatever the reason, then citation has to be served. Citation is a, in probate proceedings it is called citation, but it's a notice. You have to, that you so and so has filed a probate petition, you give, you within 14 days, if you have any objection, file your caveat objection, otherwise it will be deemed consent by you. Suppose he files the consent, he files the caveat, then the suit is, the petition is converted into suit, then the regular trial begins. Now the trial, and suppose if any outsider or person who has no caveatable interest and files the caveat, then what is the remedy? All other heirs are accepting. Suppose tenant files that I am not accepting the will of the landlord, then the executor will take out a motion for dismissal of the caveat and say that he has a no caveatable interest, so his caveat must be dismissed. Then after hearing, the court will decide. Now, as far as trial of the probate suit is concerned, it's like a regular suit. First, issues are framed. There are three stages. First stage, documentation. Trial of the probate suit, documentation, pleadings. Second, evidence. And third, arguments. Now, first stage, after first issues are framed, once matter is, petition is on, because of the citation, caveat petition is converted into suit, then the suit comes for directions, issues are framed. And the issues are framed on the basis of the objections raised in the caveat. So then issues are framed on the basis of the caveat and pleadings. Then first the plaintiff has to prove. And as far as the plaintiff is, propounder is concerned, the first witness who goes into the box is the attesting witness, not the plaintiff. Because it is the attesting witness who will prove the document that this is the will which was signed by in my presence. Now, we all know we have two witnesses to make will has to be legal documents. Even one witness can be called to the court, and he can on oath he can say that I have seen him. We all three were present. In our presence, he has signed. He was in proper state of mind, and he knew that he was executing the will. And we all three were simultaneously together. Now then, he will be cross-examined by the caveater. This is the first stage of trial. So first attesting witness goes in the box. Then he is cross-examined. Thereafter, if there are any other witnesses, suppose you want to produce second witness, attesting witness, suppose both are available, then you have to decide ultimately in a trial. Ultimately, you have to apply your, you have to see the facts and circumstances of the each case. Then second witnesses goes. Then last, the petitioner will go in the box. Means propounder of the will. And one thing you must keep it in mind. Whenever you, suppose your matter is converted into suit, then the documents you rely in this testamentary trial, minimum documents, only will and the death certificate. And will and the death certificate of the deceased. Unless you are sure that you have our documents on which, if you are, now see, if you are for the propounder, then your approach towards the matter will be different. And if you are for caveater, then your approach will be different. Then, as a propounder, your duty how to prove the will. So suppose some admitted signatures are there, but generally we will not go for those documents. Only generally caveater will say okay, that signature doesn't match with this admitted signature, so that is not his signature. But then that propounder will go into the box, and as far as the plaintiff's evidence will be over, then the caveater, first caveater goes. But now when you file a caveat, suppose you are for the caveater, what precautions you must take? Suppose client comes with a you citation and he asks you, okay, I want to challenge the will. First thing, file Vakalatnama and take inspection of the original will which is deposited in the High Court. I am sure you all must be aware that all original wills are deposited in High Court the day High Court was established, 1862, all original wills are deposited. They are never returned. Even if you withdraw the petitions, original wills are never returned, because they are more sacred documents. Like Gita, Bible and Quran, you can't change. Suppose today you file a petition, tomorrow you withdraw, then day after tomorrow you come with another will of the same deceased and you file. That is why the original will is never written. So whenever you are for the caveater, before entering the caveat, you must take inspection of the original will along with your client who wants to challenge. Because you have to see and observe, because you will get many points from the original document. Suppose it is suspicious circumstances, suppose deceased was in a hospital, you are sure, you have a documents that he could not have signed on that day, or you could have said that deceased was not in Bombay, or even attesting witness was not in Bombay on the date on which it was signed. So all these points will occur to you only when you take an inspection and you take instructions from your client. Then once, same procedure for examination, affidavit in lieu of examination of the caveater. And please keep it in mind, unless you are able to prove your allegations, don't make allegations only for the sake of making. Because once propounder discharges burden that deceased has executed the will in accordance with the law, and he proves that he was of sound mind, and witness also says, and you are not able to say, then moment you say that he was not, then you should be able to prove your case then only. Otherwise it is very difficult becomes for the caveater to disclose the will which was properly executed and which has been proved in evidence. So you have to be very careful when you have to challenge the will. You prove it, you come with a evidence, such a evidence that nobody can disclose you, and you can show beyond doubt that on that day will could not have been executed. Now, you know, will is a very sacred document. And second thing, that ultimately it is the wishes of the deceased. So it has not only, this litigation has not only commercial aspect. It requires very fine, delicate interest and moral fiber, because ultimately you are dealing with the wishes of the deceased. After that evidence is over, matter goes for the arguments, then judge will weigh, and that is the, and the, either party can go in appeal. That is the position. I have given you brief idea of what is this testamentary and intestate succession and procedure and everything. Ultimately, it depends upon each and every case, facts and circumstances. You have to study and you have to apply the law, and mostly it's ultimately the human angle, human approach to this matter. Because when the question of interpretation and construction of the will comes, there is a doctrine of rule of armchair. When the that rule of armchair, it is in the Succession Act. Judges, when question, because the once will is probated, then only the question of interpretation and construction comes. So judges put themselves in the place of the deceased, and they think, why this is made such a will, he excluded this heir, he gave more to this heir, what was the reason? For that, he has to see the family background, he has to see the relation of the heirs and the beneficiaries with the deceased, and his social status and everything. That rule of armchair is known when the judge put himself. Because this is ultimately, you are proving the document of a person who is not on this earth. So you have to be very careful. Thank you. Anybody has any question?
Now there will be a question answer session. Those who want to have, they can ask their question.
Will, original will. Yes. No.
After serving a citation.
Either you must have received the citation. Or even now, you know, internet is there, website is there, so people keep on watching that whether somebody proceedings are there. So if you are heir and if you have a caveatable interest, then your name must be mentioned in the probate petition. So you are entitled to file vakalat nama. And you can mention, you can file caveat, and if a citation is not served, then you can file a caveat and you can mention that I have not been served the citation, so my caveat is within time, because then 14 days time limitation doesn't run for you. So you can file, there is no problem, provided you have a caveatable interest. You should be sure that you are entitled to get from this disease. Like if you are tenant and wants to challenge the will of the landlord, then you cannot file. You will file caveat, you take inspection, but your caveat will be dismissed ultimately. Throughout India. Outside also, but Yes. But part of the property of the deceased or residence of the deceased must be in Bombay. No. It applies to all the properties. No, then you have to satisfy the court that I am the heir and they have made a wrong statement. You have to show your relationship with the deceased. But if you are related to deceased, you must be aware that he is a deceased and he is related to you, so you are entitled to get. For that, you have to approach your lawyer and find out whether you must see. You must have some relation with the person who dies, that he is your related, he has no issue, you are entitled to get. So that much work you have to do. Of course, you take out application and I have not been cited and you file caveat and tell the court that I should be cited in the petition. I am an heir, I am entitled to get, I have a caveatable interest. So your caveat will not be dismissed. No, any ground, because you are entitled to serve citation. And suppose if citation is not served and is not disclosed the rightful heir and probate or letter of administration is obtained, then under 263 you come for revocation. That fraud has been paid, has been for 3 years from the date of knowledge, but that you have to justify. And for filing of the petition there is no probate, but you have to explain the delay.
The tenancy rights are not bequeathable.
Yes.
But the probate will be granted. Though by then, what will be the repercussion of such a grant?
That is not enforceable against the tenancy.
Which court will decide that whether it will take effect or not?
No. Even if the tenancy is mentioned in the will, it will not take any effect. The tenancy court, small cause court, will decide who are the heirs under 511C all. And they are the heirs, and first the person who was staying with them, he has to prove that he was staying with the deceased. And if there are, he doesn't prove, then the heirs can claim the tenancy. But the probate will not have effect on the tenancy right.
Sir,
yes.
You said the first witness is, witness in the box is obviously attesting witness.
Yes.
Now, if both the witnesses have expired.
Very good question. Yes. In our matter, one of our matters is a reported judgment. Will was of 1969. Both the attesting witness were dead. Then there is a provision under Rule 384 of Original Side Rules. The person who was present at the time of the execution of the will and who has seen all the three persons, the person who made the will, signed the will, and two witnesses signing. I was present, I have seen all three persons signing in my presence, though I am not a witness to this, but I am witness to that incident. I was present in the room, I have seen them. So if he comes into the box, he gives evidence, and if his cross-examination is also done, and it is proved beyond doubt that he is saying the truth, then probate can be granted. So any person under Rule 384, even both the witnesses are there, then somebody who was present, you have to find out who was present and you have to produce him as a witness to that incident.
But can a propounder of a will be the only witness in the box?
No. Because he is an interested party, and then the will, because the propounder will has to see, probate court is court of conscience, not suspicious. So propounder has to prove that will was properly done without any influence, fear or favor. So if only the propounder is there in, as a witness, then the court will look with very highly suspicious and will be very careful on granting the probate on only on the evidence of the propounder, all other witness not being there. Because he has played the major role in the witness. We don't know, he has compelled the testator to sign, he has forced him.
Interested.
Because he is an interested party, he is a beneficiary. So court will be very careful. And if you are for the propounder, never bring such witness, him as in the witness box.
Person who was.
You have to find that person. But provided he is executor can be attesting witness. He cannot be a beneficiary. So executor, if he is not beneficiary, then he can say. Executor can be attesting witness. There is no problem. But beneficiary or relatives of the beneficiary generally cannot be a witness because they are becomes interested party. Yes. No, only one. Only one. Because sometimes what happens, the more you witness comes and more both you, suppose they become nervous and give conflicting stories, then unnecessary there will be a problem. Only one. The attesting witness, no, in court only one witness has to come, yes. In court only one witness has to come. Yes, they, and always keep it in mind, as far as the witnesses are concerned, always select the witness who are younger to the person who makes the will. Otherwise, sometimes whatever witness goes earlier. Yes.
What is the effect of doctor's certificate for deciding genuineness of the will and whether it is a mandatory?
As far as registration of the will is concerned, the doctor's certificate is nowadays mandatory. And of course, if you obtain the certificate of a doctor, then if doctor is ready and willing to come and give evidence, so then in my presence on that day only I was present, and it makes a difference. It carry away. Yes, no problem.
It is said that probate is not a judgment in rem. Can you expand that?
No. There are three kinds of judgment which are in rem: insolvency, testamentary, and winding up. Those judgments are available against the entire world. Because once the probate is issued of the last will of the deceased, then nobody can say this is not the last will unless he finds out, unless that probate is revoked. And insolvency, once a person is declared insolvent, it is available against the entire world. And winding up proceedings against the company. Those, these three kinds of judgment are always the judgment in rem available against the entire world. Otherwise, other judgments are in personam, between only dealers to two persons, like contract. You enter into an agreement for sale with the builder and you file a suit and decree. Only two are concerned. The world is not concerned, but probate is concerned. You can show to the entire world that I have probate. And the probate clears the title and severs the link of other beneficiary and claimants. So there is no shortcuts. If probate is must, many societies in Bombay on the ground of on the basis of indemnity, affidavit, they transfer the flat. And the people say, let us save the money and everything. But tomorrow it might happen. It's not a proper transfer and legal transfer. Because tomorrow, one of the beneficiary who has signed, he can say that, no, I am withdrawing my consent. And his children can also claim, this is not a proper legal transfer. So probate cuts entire future relation with other branch and the only the will shall prevail once it is probated. No, because heirship is only mere declaration. So the transfer of property for probate and success, it depends upon the nature of the property, because nowadays even our high court asks for the court fee on the heirship also, because the value of the property has gone, and people used to, earlier there used to be exemption for ladies, so everybody used to file through by the in the name of the lady, that exemption was withdrawn. Yes. Yes, entire. Proportionality, only part of the property rests outside Bombay, Maharashtra, no problem. There is no problem. Probate is granted only after completion of all the formalities and requirements as per the law. So it's a, once probate is granted, it's a foolproof procedure is completed. So no chance is there unless that person shows that he was not cited. He shows special circumstances and he comes for revocation under 263. And if court is satisfied that why he could not be become aware of the proceedings, then only court will venture into. And second thing, that very important, there is a one judgment also, that during the tenure of the probate proceedings, if the some property is transferred to third person by executors and regularly, and subsequently if the probate is revoked, then the revocation operates prospectively, not retrospectively. The transfer is not invalid, the property is gone. It is an office work. It will not come before the judge. Yes. Suit, yes. Yes, 1, 2, 3 is no problem. Suppose only one executor is there, then either other executors reserve their right, or you file their affidavit that they want to denounce. Any one or two can apply, there is no problem. No, executor, but... Yes, jointly. It depends upon the wording of the will. How the deceased has decided who will be the executor, whether jointly or separately, that is how it has to be decided. If doctor is willing, no problem. It depends upon your relation with the doctor, deceased relation. Because the job of the executor is very onerous. Ultimately, it is between the executor and the testator. Because who will take responsibility?
Sir, there is one question. How legal heirs certificate varies from the succession certificate, and what is their respective implementation?
The succession certificate, if you want to transfer the property, like shares, securities, bank, then succession certificate, you have to pay the full court fee. Heirship, only mere declaration for, you know, lower authorities like talati, revenue records and transfer of tenancy, but nowadays even virtually the value court fee is also on the heirship has gone equal to succession certificate. So it's advisable you apply for movable property, so title is properly passed, succession certificate. Because heirship is not under Indian Succession Act, it's under Bombay Regulations Act 3 of... Yes. He has to, immovable property cannot be transferred without registered document. So he has to pay release deed, stamp duty, register. Once LA is granted, then he can execute the release deed, but not before that. No, he gives consent, but then when he has to, when administrator will wants to transfer the property, that time he has to execute the release deed. And if release deed involves the immovable property, then it document has to be registered. Because for immovable, you know, in contract, 100 rupees more property cannot be without registered document. Even that, because even that blood relation from, not brother to brother, from release deed is release deed between the co-sharers. Creditor will have to file the suit for recovery against the beneficiaries and heirs to the extent they receive the share of the deceased property. So they are not without any remedy, but they have to find out. Doesn't matter, Bombay residence is there, address is there, you can file letter of administration. For probate there is no problem. He must have gone temporary for 1 month, no? But Bombay residence. Some properties in Bombay. Try to bring jurisdiction in Bombay.
So my query is whether grant of LA or probate declares title of the deceased in the property mentioned. Whether it is
no.
A conclusive proof.
No. Probate court is not a court of title. They are not concerned with the title. They mere declaration, legal representation of the heirs, legal representation that these heirs are the legal representative heirs of the deceased. And the will is genuine. These are the only two. Legal representation and the document will is genuine. Only these two issues. Rest civil court.
There is one question.
Whether doctor certificate is mandatory in each and every cases? That is one question.
Certainly not.
Not
but
in what cases it is necessary?
If will is to be registered, then the doctor certificate is compulsory.
Yes. Another question is about filing of succession certificate, petition of succession certificate, where it should be filed, where deceased died or where company's office is located.
Residence of the deceased, succession certificate is the residence of the deceased, irrespective wherever property is of the family.
Another thing, the after contest, a probate petition is granted, grant is issued, whether it is a decree or executable?
No, it's mere a declaration. Then executor, because once property is granted, then the executor will administer and distribute the property as per the direction contained in the will. If he doesn't do, then the beneficiary can file a suit that he is not doing, or he can file a removal of the executor or administrator under section 301 of Indian succession.
One second.
Certainly not. Witness is not supposed to read. Only he should be clear in mind that the deceased was in proper frame of mind, and he understood, and he must have disclosed that I am signing the will. You attest. This is my. I am signing before you, and you are signing before me. That's all. That's all. They are not concerned with the will, contents of the will.
If Muslim person execute the will, whether that Muslim personal law will prevail or that will be
successful. Personal law. As far as India is concerned, succession, adoption, marriage, everything, personal law prevails. We have no so far uniform civil court. It depends upon the relation with the testator. if testator has given him 5 lakhs of rupees for executor, you keep it and you spend all this amount. Generally, the provisions is made in the will that the executor will spend. But generally, once person expires, then executor can't operate his account because probate is not granted. So ultimately, he has to manage the show. And it depends upon the relation. That is why I said the job of the executor is very onerous and cumbersome and not, one gets the credit easily unless he is a family member. So generally what is to be done, only beneficiary is to be made executor. Of course, it depends upon the ideas of the deceased who gives who wants to make a will. Because we can't impose all our ideas from the point of law because we have to take care of the emotions of the testator. Sorry? Residence of? No, then you have to file, then probate is not compulsory, but you have to file petition. If there is no dispute, then you have to file the petition in the district court.
District court.
There is one more question. What is living will? It's legality and enforceability.
Living will.
Living will.
Living will. See, one can write anything in the will, but will comes into operations only after probate is granted. And that time, what is the circumstances, who are the heirs, and to what extent practically the will is enforceable, one has to take that situation. And you have to decide, it depends upon facts and circumstances. Suppose, if person is not there, then that share will go as per the residue clause.
Person executes a will, whether it can be probated.
Yes.
Under Indian succession.
Yes. But under the
person. Or the person.
No. Because they are, there is a restrictions on that, not more than
1/6.
They cannot
sell. Daughter is only having 1/6. Then
one of the beneficiary heir becomes administrator. He applies for letter of administration with will annex. Because the only probate can be applied by executor or any other person LA with will come.
Now I will request our president.
Sorry. One testamentary suit. The caveat will not appear or attend before the at the time of trial. So what should be
the then trial has to be completed. You put your witness in the box and prove because it is already converted into suit.
So the petition can take the ex parte order?
Yes, sir.
Now I will request Sri Ram Reddy to felicitate our speaker.
वंदे मातरम् वंदे मातरम् सुजलाम् सुफलाम् मलयजशीतलाम् सस्यशामलाम् मातरम् वंदे मातरम् शुभ्रज्योत्स्नाम् पुलकितयामिनी फुल्लकुसुमिताम् द्रुमदल शोभिनी सुहासिनी सुमधुरभाषिनी सुखदां वरदां मातरं वंदे मातरं वंदे मातरं। भारत माता की जय।